So before we go on, I just want to check on some sports stats, you know, keep myself sharp here on the sports, and I'll use my computer and just go in here and I'm going to check, okay.
Monday, June 21st, we are living in a post-emergency pod world. My name is Dave, KJ's here, Dylan's here. Lads, how do you feel about the emergency pod that we dropped Friday that no one saw coming, quite literally?
Since it's about Mavericks basketball, I have not listened to said pod. KJ what? May have, on the other hand.
Well, he was on it.
Oh. I thought it was just you and Jake.
No, KJ was on.
The disrespect.
You didn't think KJ could talk basketball?
My bad, player. Just
mixing it up?
I know he can. I just didn't know he did.
See, first he forgets the NBA in the tweets. Now he forgets me in the NBA podcast. I see that.
Some people, you're never going to live that tweet down.
Say, I fumbled big time, man. I thought the idea behind the tweet was solid, but I just, you know.
If you don't know what we're talking about, you can see said tweet on the Too Much Dip Twitter account. That's Too Much Dip with two P's on Twitter. Dylan had been prepping me all day for this tweet he was going to get off. He's like, dude, I need the login.
I don't know if I prepped him all day. I asked him for a login.
I got a tweet I've just been itching to get off.
When you were telling about this, you said he was been grooming you all morning. But you're using the word prep now.
Prepped, yeah. Okay. Prep is different.
He wasn't grooming you for the moment. I got you.
He was not grooming me for the moment. And when I saw it on there, I saw it because KJ had tweeted a response to it because there was a glaring omission, you know. It's okay. It's not that big of a deal.
You know,
nobody go look at it and like it.
I included the three sports that I was most excited about, and it just didn't include basketball for me. I was very much into the golf. I was very much into the puck. And, of course, college baseball, very much into that as well.
Of course, he says.
Of course. Basketball, I was like, oh, yeah, there's also like a very important basketball game tonight after the fact. But people got it. The idea behind the tweet still came across in the tweet. People laughed.
We're supposed to be like a left-leaning podcast, man. Remember, that's what they said? We can't be out here just riding with those three sports.
All of this centering around a tweet that included a Turning Point keynote speaker.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what are you doing?
Who?
Trump was at a Turning Point convention, okay. Which,
No, this isn't. That's not what's going on here.
Look, we set politics aside when it comes to cum jokes.
Mostly, yeah. Yeah. Apolitical when it comes to semen.
It was still funny. Whatever.
Hey, it's great to have KJ back in studio.
After several days outside of the country, it really gave me the perspective to, you know, just really appreciate, you know, the things that you have. You know, be where your feet are, if you will. So I'm just glad to be back in here mobbing with the boys. After the emergency pod, you know, it was another reminder that we all have a lot in our lives. Some of us also have children who want to be on the podcast. And you're like, hey, you can't really rock
yet.
With us. It's not, we're not going four wide today. He said, fuck that. You know what? I'm a mob.
You know, and it was a real wake-up call. It was like, hey, you moved into your new place, Dave. You just, unfortunately, you don't have like any privacy whatsoever to record a pod. And maybe sometimes you're going to have to deal with a screaming baby.
The acoustics weren't what you thought they were?
They weren't. And I there was a minute where I thought maybe I'll go do this on like my back porch. But I didn't do it. It would have been very hot. You know how it is in Texas, summertime. Is today the summer solstice? Is that how this works? Today the first day?
Today is midsummer day, for sure.
What does that even mean?
Oh, it's where you travel to another country with a woman after her family commits like multi-person murder sue. And then you get tied up in this like weird cultish situation that revolves around like the female reproductive organs. It was a good movie. You should watch it.
What the hell is he talking about?
There's no chance in the world Dylan's seen Midsommar.
It's a Michael Bay movie.
I don't think it is.
A lot of explosions.
I don't think it is.
Things of that nature.
But yeah, I have not seen Midsommar. Summer?
Yeah.
Who knows?
It's about a real basic, like, average to below average wine taster.
Which I don't look like the guy from fucking Psalm.
He flunked out of Psalm school, but he's still, like, he's adequate at it.
Yeah, like.
Yeah, just, he works at, like, Outback.
His palate's fine.
Yeah.
It's kind of mid.
He's like, yeah.
Mid palate.
Here, try some Mums.
If Follow us on Instagram, Too Much Dip Podcast there. We'll post viral memes and videos. Maybe we'll give Dylan the keys and see what kind of gold he can whip up. We did post your idea on there.
Yeah. So, you know, there's something behind it.
No, it was a good tweet. It was just, yeah. It was funny because there was a little bit of buildup with me. Dylan's like, can I get the login? I was like, yeah. And then when I saw it, then KJ just torpedoed it.
It was bad on my part, on my behalf. That was bad gamesmanship. And I have no defense.
No, it's okay.
But I'm fairly enough assumed that anybody but Dylan had sent the tweet, which is...
Don't pull punches on.
Before yesterday, you did not have the login, nor did I, pulling the curtain back. So I assumed it was, maybe Luka Doncic that I could throw some shots at. And as the day went on, like, I was also throwing shots at, like, baseball and other shows. Like, am I warring with Dylan for no reason?
Now that your boy has the login, look out. I might start firing from the hip.
Tweet thread incoming.
Yeah.
All right, you know what that means. Time to hit the dip line.
It's time to hit the dip line. 833-371-DIP. Again, 833-371-DIP with two P's. Remember, dip responsibly. Oh, and this one, it's for Dippy.
I was going to say, I might just be like Ben Simmons in the fourth quarter, just shooting everything.
Okay. At least we know,
I know a little bit about basketball over the weekend. Man.
They'll be grammatically correct if so, though. We can respect that.
Okay.
Do I have to do the dip line introduction again?
No, I think they get the point.
It's the dip line.
Yeah.
We're going to take a break from the NASCAR Minute. We respect the NASCAR Minute, but we got to check in with somebody else.
NASCAR Minute might have got cucked by I'm bringing my cooler to the fucking NASCAR track guy.
Oh.
And, if you don't know what I'm talking about, go find him. We'll put it on the IG later.
Put it on the IG. Let's hit the dip line. Yeah.
Wasabi here, Pekingese Grand Champion, World Champion, Westminster Dog Show, and I didn't appreciate how last week's episode ended. One second.
David, is this freaking Purina? I'm not eating this crap. Get it out of here.
Sorry. First of all, if you bring a silly little golden retriever in the ring with me, I'm going to dominate his silly little ass up and down the runway because he's not ready for the heat that Wasabi brings to the table. And two, put some respect in my b-hole. Some of us are willing to do what it takes to be a world champion, unlike, I don't know, Dylan. So, okay. Wasabi out.
Of course, Wasabi's referencing the time that Dylan lost a bet and was supposed to have his anus hole bleached and chose to not ever have said anus hole bleached. But that's cool that Wasabi checked in with us. And, you know, Wasabi is spicy, known as it's a hot food. So,
you know how I know that wasn't the real Wasabi?
It was a human.
Well, no. What are you talking about? No. I think Purina is like the number one sponsor of the Westminster Dog Show, right?
Oh, shit.
So he wouldn't be dogging a sponsor like that if he's a consummate professional showman.
That's what dogs do.
I'm just saying that might be a fake Wasabi. I'm just saying.
You're saying that Wasabi just kind of sounded like just an average dude firmly in our demographic?
Yeah.
I believe it was a real Pekingese. It just wasn't Wasabi.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. And Paul, okay.
I'm not eating that crap. Yeah, you would be eating it.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of vets recommend Purina. They actually have real nutritionists on staff.
9 out of 10, facts. Probably.
9 out of 10. Big facts.
Okay.
Can I say something I'll no doubt regret?
Okay.
In defense, you know, this is my olive branch, if you will, to Dylan for, you know, coming out of his neck on Twitter and then
calling
just
me
being
a racist sports observer, basically.
Did he call you that?
He alluded to it. He alluded to it.
You did pick three of the three whitest sports.
Actually, yeah.
I was going to say F1.
Baseball's not that.
But the best F1
white
driver's a black dude.
That's true.
Although maybe not the best
right
now.
Sports. Okay, whatever.
V-step.
Yeah. Let's check the records.
It's okay.
3 to 103.
It's fair.
So, Dylan, I want to, as you will, untether you from this bleaching narrative. It's been like four different podcasts.
I would
podcasts
appreciate that. Thank you.
In many, many years. In your defense here.
Right.
Have either of you ever bleached your hair, frosted tips, anything of the sort?
Dave definitely
buddy
has.
Okay.
Do you even have to ask?
Well, I respect that. I never asked to. I never tried. But Dennis Rodman was a very popular athlete in our day.
The Worm.
Eminem was, you know, a central figure in like my fifth grade to like seventh or eighth or ninth grade music interests. And so bleaching your hair was a great concept. But in the world that I lived in, had I shown up to school with like even gold hair or like yellow, it would have been an ass whipping.
Cisco hair?
Exactly. Exactly. It wouldn't have been a macho look, if you will. But I was still committed to the decision that, you know, I would like to alter my look in some way. Along the same time, I, you know, began to grow hair elsewhere. So okay. I took some Clorox once.
No.
Dumped it a rag and just fucking went to town on the muff. And
wait a minute.
For like 7 months, I was just walking around with like auburn hair.
You said on the muff?
You know, bush, whatever you want to call it.
What are you doing?
Wait,
dog?
What?
Facts. I'm just in the trust tree.
Hey, wait, are you saying that you bleached your pubes?
Hey, this isn't the trust tree, man. You got
your hair. Like, serious
there's
question.
There's four of us in the room here. Nobody else is going to know about this.
Tons of people listening.
Are you talking about the hair on top of your head or your actual
downstairs?
You're downstairs.
I didn't have Manscaped back then to handle the problem, so I was just very shocked that for like many, many weeks, like it endured. So. You know, whatever.
KJ, this live is and something. Learn. This is something.
Wait.
I sure you want us to edit this out? Are you going to write
it? I'll live with it, man. It's been said on a podcast, was heard by like 37 people that week.
How did it, did you have any reaction to actually just putting bleach?
There was no skin irritation, you know? So that was a surprise.
I don't know what to make of this, David.
I don't care.
I'm as perplexed as you seem
I was
to be.
In the eighth grade. I don't give a fuck. So.
I think, if anything, this makes Dylan look
statute
worse.
Statute of limitations.
What are you talking about?
He voluntarily put Clorox on his downstairs Merkin region.
I believe he called it a muff.
His muff. His words,
yeah,
not
yeah,
mine.
Whatever.
Paul Azinger's words
dude
as well.
Pube. People might be eating their lunch. I just wanted to soften it.
And you had a chance to get cleaned up back there and get a bleaching so you could have like the perfect
from the guy
Westminster
who,
dog show.
By the way, like
the guy who refused to
too.
Wear an oversized Arby's polo to a bar. This doesn't mean much coming from you, Dave.
Oh, wow.
All offense intended.
Well, all I know is I learned it from somewhere, and you are the OG of not paying out bets.
As Judge Joe Black in here, I will side with the plaintiff here.
What? How?
Your payoff was so easy.
Oh, yours
so,
wasn't? You were
so
you were getting a benefit.
So inconsequential.
You were benefiting it. You would always complain about how messed up your butthole is,
I'm
and you had
a
chance to
have
it paid
beautiful
for
butthole.
By the company, would have paid for it.
Doubt it.
I don't know. The
how
fact
much
that
is that?
Austin Westlake, dermatologist, or whomever it was, had an opportunity to see your nether regions, and you passed on that. You know,
it's a hot clinic.
Imagine just getting on all fours on a table. And
I don't believe
that.
No.
They
spread cheeks,
they put your feet behind your ears.
Exactly.
That's so much worse.
And afterward, they take you outside to take in some vitamin D. They let you sun it.
I don't think they do that.
They hold both ankles with one hand.
I don't think
and
they
go
do
to
that.
Town with the other hand.
That sounds like a sex move that I don't want to be a part of.
Let's move along. Let's get back to the sports. How do we get down this road? What are y'all doing here?
Well, you just volunteered up that story, and I am. I know I'm not giving it the proper due, and I feel like if we just move on to actual sports, I'm going to think of something later.
Well, it was either that or I like talk about going to Playa Mujeres and having a dope-ass time or get my wisdom teeth out and like that being pretty chill. But like everyone knows I'm built different. It wasn't going to be a big deal, so I figured I'd offer up something of value.
Everyone knows I'm built different, he says.
Well, we do know that.
6-hour recovery from wisdom teeth. Step up, people.
This dude might be built different. I mean,
and you wouldn't even get that thang bleached.
Would you shut up?
There's like no.
I tried. I really tried. In the end.
Thanks for calling in.
Yeah, that's my dip line.
Wasabi.
My live dip line.
Oh my god. So okay, did y'all even have time to watch the U.S. Open yesterday? Did you watch the golf?
I watched quite a bit of it. Quite a bit.
I was on a golf breeze for a little. I didn't catch like 8 hours of it. I do love afternoon tee off times for sure, or like late morning.
Do you like prime time golf?
Yes.
Little West Coast
Thursday,
golf.
Friday for sure.
All I could think about watching Louis play 18 was Dylan just being in a similar position a few years back, and then just blading a chip.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that back up. Yeah, I did.
That's all I could think about.
Yeah.
Amongst all the greatness. Were you excited to see Rom win his first major?
Sure. I'm a Rom guy. I'm not a big Rom guy, but I do appreciate John Rom.
Can I say that
I know he's part of a short backswing clique that you're in.
I'm in that clique. I don't necessarily ride with him. I don't necessarily rock with him. even though he's rocking with us. But it was – he was – he's obviously a worthy champion. Birdieing 17 and 18 was sick. Those putts were unbelievable. You don't see that. Like, literally, they some stat about the last time somebody birdied the last two holes to win the U.S. Open. Hasn't happened since, I think, Tom Watson. But I don't know. Something about Rahm, maybe it's like his on-course, like, borderline meltdowns. And maybe it's just that I'm more tired of the narrative of, he's got his emotions under control. Like, that's kind of the cliche. And that's not really his fault. So, but it was cool. His wife was there. Phil was there. Arizona State, stand up. This is your moment. It's basically a home game for him. That's what people will tell you. He loves San Diego. Proposed to his wife there. I don't know if you guys heard that.
Yeah, but I would call it home game for, like, what, Xander Schauffele? Or was it Patrick Cantlay, who's, like, from San Diego or what?
Phil's a San Diego guy.
And Phil's a San Diego guy. So,
of course.
You know. I think for Rahm, I immediately went back to everything he'd gone through over the last two or three weeks. And by he'd gone through, you know, chose to go through by not having his vaccination sooner. But I don't mean that in kind of a grandstanding, preachy kind of way. I mean it in the sense that, like, we all know what happened. The way he handled everything after that moment, he deserves as much credit as possible. He owned up to it. He's like, you know what? I should have got my vaccination sooner. It's kind of how his public response that I saw, at least, was.
He definitely handled it well. I would not have handled it that way. I would have been scorched earth. I would have thrown some shade at the tour. And in fact, a lot of people did throw shade at the tour for him, but he didn't. And credit to him, he credits his positive or his victory, you know, on his positive outlook.
Mm-hmm.
There's something to it. I mean, everybody knows this podcast, we do nothing but positive thinking before we come in here.
Positive
vibes. We're on that
only.
Positive-ish.
Yeah, major props to him. It would have been so easy to be just pissed off at the world at that point and just let it affect your game. Didn't do it. Played very, very well. Had it closed out strong, as we saw.
I would have been inside my room just listening to Slipknot.
Well, that sounds like a good day. I'm just glad he didn't take the Cole Beasley route.
What is that?
You just get on Twitter and you're like, I'm effing quit. This is bullshit. You know, it's trash. I don't know if you saw the, unfortunately, an SMU grad or alumni.
Dez kind of played that same card.
Yeah, but Dez isn't in the league and didn't go 10 pages deep with, I'm going to live my life however I want. Be scared of me. Anyhow, back
to Rahm. Also, Dez never got in the booth and recorded a terrible hip hop album.
Just dropped like bar after bar. Just straight
three
heat.
Different albums, by the
just
way.
Just heat.
Three. Kill a Beast.
Three albums.
But on back to Rahm real quick. I think that we're going to obviously get to Big DeChambeau here in a minute.
That's what people are saying, but yeah.
But
44 on the back.
The fact that Rahm didn't bogey a single hole in his final 15 when everybody, you know, Rory, Koepka, everyone picked up a bogey along the way, down the line, like that made it even more impressive. I don't really even feel like Louis choked this away in any form or fashion because the whole field played about as well or, you know, subpar as he did. Rahm just fucking stood above the crowd, and I'm glad he ended up taking that winnow.
Yeah, unfortunately for Louis, 17 is what he'll be thinking about.
Mm-hmm.
Put it in the penalty area left. When you have all the room right, you miss right, you're fine. You know, you might be in the rough. You might catch a bad lie there, or you're probably going to be in the sand, but you're not out of the hole. I thought he was going to make that putt to save par. I was hoping for it because I wanted it. You want to see it come down to 18. Some people in the group text were giving him shit about laying up on 18 from, like, what do you have, 221, 225 or something.
243, I think.
243 out of thick rough.
Yeah.
And absolute, I think there had been one eagle all day on 18, and no one was holding that green. You're not going to hold that green from that rough. You're not going to be able to put spin on the ball. So his best chance
was a borderline impossible shot.
Yeah. So I don't know what Dan, AKA Jack Hammer, mm-hmm. friend of the show, he immediately was like, oh, you got to go for it there. I was like, what was he going to do?
Yeah.
Like, it was like, you going to just mash a five iron with some spin on it out of the rough. Whatever. The tournament was done. And I feel bad for Louis. He's Mr. Second Place. He was actually my pick, fun fact.
Smoothest swing in golf, man.
I do like his swing.
It's beautiful.
It's kind of swaggy. The way they talk about him on the course, though, is like it's like he's walking around on opioids or something. They're like, oh, there's Louis. He's just so calm and relaxed. Look at him. He doesn't have a care in the world. Doesn't even know where he is. No, he does. Well, he does.
What pissed, well, I won't say pissed me off, but what caught me off guard in their description about Louis was, and this guy from South Africa, from 150-acre ranch in South Africa, and I'm like, okay, quite privileged.
That sounds sick, yeah.
He's like, he's just a country boy and would rather be out on a John Deere. And I'm like, I don't know how many John Deeres there are rolling around South Africa. A little different game. He's like, just bought a large acreage ranch in Ocala. So he's been, Ocala, Florida. So he's been tied up with that and would really just like to be back home on the ranch. And I'm like, Florida and South Africa, and they're like pitching this like Yellowstone lifestyle. And I'm like, okay, let's pump the brakes here. Like, Louis's got cash, you know, he's chilling, he's good. It's not that he's out there like with a spittoon and fucking overalls.
this is a lot like the George W. Bush narrative.
Oh yeah,
the just going back down to, where was that ranch?
Camp
at?
David?
No, not Camp David.
Oh, not Camp David. Near
not Meridian. Down by Waco. Doesn't
yeah, near matter. Waco. It starts with a C though. Comfort.
Okay.
No, that's not right either. Keep going on.
But they're just like, yeah, you know, he likes to go down there and clear brush to just kind
of
think about stuff.
Need to get the picture of him on a knee.
Fixing a fence.
Just holding some shrubbery. Is that the same ranch they had to know? It was Rick Perry who had to get a name of a ranch changed.
Okay, I think that was before he had taken ownership. It was
just didn't get around to changing
the world
sign.
Of bad ranch names, it is the worst ranch name.
Yeah, we won't even get into it here. On a podcast that
I forgot
just
about
a bleaching
I honestly
incident.
Forgot about Rick Perry. former Aggie great, Dylan.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, he went to A&M.
Okay. I've put it off long enough. Not like I'm in here as a diehard Bryce DeChambeau stan at any moment. It was not a good look for SMU alums this weekend by any means.
Why?
Between Cole Beasley's tweet thread and then Bryson's Sunday, all of the talk about Bryson DeChambeau's weekend was about how he'd gone to sleep and found his swing between Thursday and Friday, and then his defense had worked his way into tied for first at one point on Sunday.
I think he had the lead going into the back nine.
Like, bust, you know, nothing miraculous.
That sounds
played really,
correct.
Really well.
It was his to lose. I mean, in my mind, after about five holes, I was like, oh, Bryson's going to do this. And I was already thinking ahead to what shade he might throw at Brooks, how Brooks is going to have to react to this. Even though there was a minute there where I thought, oh, God, dude, Brooks is about to go out there and post. Like, he's going to be in the clubhouse posting, like, four under, and that's going to
look
really
good. Yeah, Brooks looked really well, too, until, what, 17 as well?
16 or 17, yeah. He had bogeyed, and then, I mean, it was over for him. My rooting interest was in Rory. That just – I knew that wasn't going to happen, but he gave us glimpses. He gave us flashes. But back to Bryson, 44 on the back, including, like, was it 17? It was 17 where he – what did he – take a snowman? What do you have, an 8?
Yes, but he'd gone bogey, bogey, double bogey, then he parred a hole, and then that's when just, I mean, as if all hell hadn't broken loose, it got
worse.
Yeah.
It didn't come down to that hole, but that was, people had some fun with that on the Twitter.
He's a painful person to watch struggle, like.
Because he's so lumbering.
That plus, I don't know if it's, why is the name blanking me? What's, Jordan Spieth. Is also, you know, people who are like, can't get a hold of his emotions, hothead, cusses out, you know, like really frustrated. But I don't get the same like discomfort from watching Jordan Spieth be pissed off over the last 4 or 5 years as I do watching DeChambeau. Like, he gets red, he gets sweaty.
Dude, he's bloated.
He's
That's
just
why.
Pissed. It's not good.
When you're big, strong golfer man, and like you're just.
You're telling a man who retains water like nobody's business. I get what you're going for.
You're just a giant jug of creatine, and you can't. And you're just losing it. Your lid's gonna pop.
All right. So on the back nine, so he was 2 under going into number 11.
Okay.
He went bogey, bogey, double bogey, yep. 3 pars in a row, quadruple bogey on 17. Oof. To finish 6 over.
Okay, but what do you do on 18?
He parred it.
Dude, it's all about the comeback.
So went from tied for first, finished tied for 25th. You think there's a...
And costing him $2.1 million.
Wow. So it cost him more. His Sunday back nine cost him more than it did Jon Rahm losing that entire tournament due to COVID.
Ouch.
Because I think the winnings for that was like $1.2 million we talked about. So, yeah, that hurts.
Is that why you're dumping off your Orgain protein shakes? Because you no longer want to be associated with Bryson?
Stonk was down.
you're offloading him on the office?
That box of protein shakes up here?
Well, I'm glad you did, but
I love them.
As I mentioned, I got my wisdom teeth out on Thursday. I thought I was going to be in bed just drinking nothing but soft foods all weekend. So I loaded up on Orgain. I was like, you know what? I really need to keep these around. If nothing else, your boy's got a head start on the gain season. I figured I'd share the wealth.
It was very nice of you.
Yeah. Yep. Quickly, McKenzie Hughes.
Balls in the tree.
Didn't know the guy before, but nothing annoyed me more than like the rule book jack off session that happened after his ball gets stuck in the tree. Like the TV shot was there. They figured everything was known. You're like, here's the clip. The ball does not come down.
Oh, you got to identify his ball.
Yes. It was just like, as opposed to another ball being in the damn tree, like, come on. That wasted like 30 minutes.
So the official story is it hit the cart path and then bounced up there and got stuck?
I didn't see it, man.
I saw the ball hit the cart path. Yeah. I don't think so either. But or, I don't know.
That would make sense because that's got to be pretty tough for a drive to land in a tree and just stay up there. But, yeah, that was a tough break. I mean, I don't think he wasn't going to pull off any miraculous comebacks, but like that cost him probably quite a bit of money.
You ever get a ball stuck in a tree, Dave?
No.
I don't think I have either. I may have and just didn't know it. Couldn't find it. Like, yeah, it's in the woods somewhere.
Now every dude out there playing Mo Williams or wherever is gonna be just like looking and they're gonna look up in the tree and be like, yeah, dude, it could be up in the tree, you know, climb it, check it out.
Guy in front of me one time got his Scotty Cameron stuck in a tree one time.
I know a lot of friends, including I think me. I've offered
a reward of $100 if we could get it down, but it was like 50 feet. It was a very big tree.
So he just, he chunked it up.
He had a bad putt and took it out on Scotty.
Intentionally threw, not like just lost grip.
Yeah, it's Scotty Cameron, the putter.
Fuck if I know.
Yeah, it's, yeah, wow. Sorry.
Oh, it's a blade. It's not a
golf plane.
Shit, if I knew.
Golf's plane.
I'm like, why are they playing
golf's plane? He didn't know.
Point guard fucking golf courses like Mo Williams. Okay, cool.
That is the course, right?
Yeah, I believe
Mo Willie.
Mo Willie.
Yeah, sure.
Morris Williams.
Okay.
Not Mo Williams, former Cleveland Cavalier.
That's okay. When I said it, but people call it Mo. Whatever.
Mo Willie.
All right. Yeah. People at home, I don't fucking know this either.
too myopic.
I don't even want to talk about the streaker because there might not be a weaker fucking sport to try to quote unquote streak in than golf.
Hey, the
wasn't
guy
even new.
Whose club did he have? By the way,
I think I guess he did have to have somebody. So he didn't bring it his own, did he?
Yeah, no one brings a club in, right?
It's not Topgolf.
Not a bad swing on the lab.
No,
it was pretty smooth.
He put a good move on.
Golf Twitter liked the tempo.
Yeah, it was good.
Honestly, he was out there for way too long before anybody did anything about it.
It was the most pathetic. Like, okay, I'm on the court. It's like standing up from the front row of an NBA game and walking out in the middle of the court.
My first thought when I saw him out there was, does the PGA Tour have security in place for this kind of things? Does this happen really? Not like football when they have security guards just surround the guy.
You got volunteers out there and spotters, but not security.
Well, whoever was on that golf cart,
back line people,
that mule, what a gator thing.
That's your MVP.
That was clutch.
That's the real winner.
That guy has some skills.
Etch his name on the trophy.
There you go.
To go out there and not fuck up the course. Like, imagine that. Like, you get out there trying to skirt and stop, and you fuck up the fairway.
Yeah.
Is he technically a streaker if he was not completely nude?
Yeah, I don't like using that term for streak for
when
non-nude.
I think of, when you say streaker, I'm thinking a dude just
you're thinking D out
D mm-hmm. and balls just bouncing around.
Yep. Sure,
I agree.
Just a messy situation. Nobody wants to touch.
Really, you're just kind of a nuisance. Call me old man, but get the fuck off my fairway if you ain't nude. D out or nothing.
Not to. I'm glad that it ended like it did with just a tackle, but like if it's a naked dude, should you be able to tase that person like to avoid like you having to?
Yes, I'm pro naked tasing.
Are you pro naked tase? What about if they're trashing an Outback Steakhouse?
1,000% pro naked tasing.
It's just like too many things. You just don't want to deal with that. Oh man, fun tournament.
Yeah,
I had fun watching, even though I had to switch to like 6 different platforms on Friday to watch.
Very sick.
I now have Peacock on my Samsung.
P what?
Okay. Did you miss the shot
tracer? Are you done?
Did you miss shot tracer or Joe Buck? Because this was first year back from Fox Sports, right?
I think
second year.
Golf fans will tell you that Fox did it. Outside of the first year they had it, Fox was fairly groundbreaking in a lot of the stuff they did. I like Joe Buck.
Agreed.
I have no issue.
He puts a lot of work
that.
Now.
I like Azinger too, and I don't know if you guys were listening, but did he try? Was he kind of trying to work in a little 69 humor there yesterday?
I do not like Azinger.
You don't?
I don't know why.
You once interviewed him for a frat blog.
It's
you literally
the
did.
The way he says things, it's just he's trying too hard to be like
kind of hokey.
He's just trying. Yeah, he's trying so hard to be like
these
like
guys
edgy
been
golf guy, and it's just they all miss for me.
These
I don't
guys,
know.
These guys have been thinking about this their entire lives, and they're nervous. Boy, I'll tell you.
Yeah, I can't do Zinger anymore.
I'll bring it up when he gets to the Olympics, but I can't stand the analyst who tells you what the person should be doing and not like, hey, this went wrong because of. Like, I'm all okay with Jack Hammer, you know, in the group text. I'm not in the group text, but you know what I mean? Being like, oh, you got to do this, you got to do that. But when an announcer's like, oh, idiot, you need to be doing this. I'm like, all right, then go golf. Like, go do it. Like, you know, don't be telling Patrick Mahomes you should have thrown it here. Like, figure it out. You can say, okay, this didn't work out, but
he should have thrown it.
Exactly.
Jim.
All right. Can I run through NBA since we're like 2 weeks behind here? And I will sprint through this.
Let's go through every game.
Every game. I'll get us through this quickly.
Oh, before we get into it, let's just say this. If you want our – check out the emergency pod we dropped Friday, Mavs. It's entirely Mavs specific. We'll probably get into – if anything we've missed, we'll talk about now. But I just want to say check it out. We had Jake Kemp on. He's our good buddy, friend of the show. He's on the ticket in Dallas, Hang Zone. Shout out to Jake for doing that.
Yes, agreed. Quality content, great insight. Jake is very Mavs obsessed, has written for The Athletic for them or about them in the past. You know, it was about as expert level as we could have asked for in terms of content. Even if you're not a Mavs fan or interested in the Mavs specifically, I'd say there's a lot of good insight into how your favorite team could explode in about 10 days.
Agree.
All right. So I was out last week, and the Westminster Dog Show was around, so obviously there was not much time for NBA. But as of last week's pod, Philly was up 2-1 in Atlanta. Phoenix had already swept Denver. The Clippers were down 2-1 to Utah, and the Bucks and Nets were tied at 2-2. This is kind of a prime example is why we don't try to go series by series and like make broad like predictions, because since then we already mentioned the Mavs blew up. Go check out the podcast. Pelicans and Wizards fired their coaches. Chris Paul tests positive for COVID. The only one out of 164 tests in the NBA. Convenient for him to like go in, hug people in the crowd, and then test positive like 5 days later. Idiot. Kawhi's out with an ACL injury. But since then, Clippers have come back. They won in 7. Philly choked away the entire series to Atlanta, and the Nets lost the Bucks in 7. What I wanted to mention there, which I think we saw most of the Kevin Durant performances the last 3 or 4 games, if you're a Nets fan, which, you know, you're probably also a Yankees fan and a Patriots fan. And
occasional Lakers fan.
Occasional Lakers. You're Cowboys. Just like LeBron. You just go where he goes. Like, are you disappointed? And obviously that they lost, but, like, what do you take of that season when you didn't ever have a fucking healthy team at all at any point?
You're obviously gutted by the injuries.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have that team, those three guys at least, together for at least another year, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe two. And I, as not a fan of the Nets, but I was pulling for them, I fully expect them to go out and run the East next year. And I think they'll be back in the they'll be in the finals next year. That being said, to get like prime KD, like beasting,
mm-hmm.
borderline GOAT status, Dylan.
He's like low key goated at this point.
I mean, he's flirting with goated.
It's like him, Elton John, Tootsies,
yes.
Kevin Durant,
just like sneaky goated.
You're feeling, you're loving that. You're liking what you're seeing. You're 8 beers in, but. You got to think, dude, how do we make moves to get this team, like, more depth on this team? Joe Harris had an awful series.
Mm-hmm.
If that dude just hits, like, 2 threes in the fourth, like, that's a whole – we're talking Nets in the finals, the Eastern Conference finals. So, I don't know, man. That's the dice you roll, or you know, with a super team.
Yeah.
Is that you've got these three guys, that's where all your resources are going, and building a team around them that can step up when two of the three are hurt. Even though Harden was out there, that dude was like 25%. He was a decoy, basically, and asked to be basically a spot-up shooter, and he couldn't hit anything.
Yeah, credit to Harden for gutting it out and getting out there. You know, what value he brought, who knows. He did put up some points in 5 and 6. you know, played a reasonable role. But anytime you've got a team where you've got Kevin Durant, Kyrie, Harden, and then, you know, you're coached by Steve Nash and you've got, what's Houston's old coach, his name?
D'Antoni.
D'Antoni on the bench, like, and you're talking about Joe Harris as, like, a reason why you may not have won, like, that's a problem.
They don't need to make any moves. They need to be healthy, I think.
Fair.
And if they don't make something happen next year, this little super team experiment will be a complete failure, I think.
Yeah. I mean, when that's your move, it's championship or bust.
I mean, the trio of Harden, Kyrie, and Durant, I mean, that's as good a super team as we've seen probably, I mean.
On paper.
I mean, that's incredible.
Since Miami.
Offensively, that's an incredible offensive trio right there. Defensively. Okay. And they have pieces around them, too. It's not like it's just those three. They have
Blake Griffin stepped up huge, for sure.
It'll be a failure if they don't win next year.
I would say the way that these teams have worked and been successful, which I'm not sure if this core can do it, we'll see this offseason, is what LeBron's been able to do is you get players running to play for pennies on your team, left and right. Shane Battier going to, well, I think Shane Battier was already in Miami. I don't know. But you got a lot of those Rondo.
Mike Bibby
was out there.
Poor Mike Bibby.
Like just going to play a role, any role on a team to make that team have depth and usually veteran depth that didn't care. They just want, you get those ring chasers. Nobody else on Brooklyn outside of Blake Griffin would you kind of categorize as like veteran experience has been there, ring chasing, and can play a really pivotal role. They had, DeAndre Jordan on the bench, but like you don't have a role for that position anymore. Not that he's not valuable, but that position, or not that he's not a good player, but that position isn't valuable to have a huge big like that in a series against, you know, Brooke Lopez where he can move around and shoot a three. Like you're just going to get outplayed. So I'm interested to see him come back next year, but I would not be shocked if again they figure out a way to screw it up if they don't get some veteran depth.
JJ Redick. That was his whole thing. Yep. He lives in Brooklyn. He wanted to be in Brooklyn. Ended up in Dallas. And I, you know what? That was hurt. I was excited for him to put on a Mavs jersey. Didn't work out. But he will probably end up on the Nets in some capacity.
And he'd be a good fit, I would say. More players like that. Because Spencer Dinwiddie wants out. Like, he was a budding star before Kyrie got there and everybody got there. So he'll have a big role somewhere else.
Compare that exit with the Philadelphia 76ers.
Oh, boy.
You're feeling a lot worse than Nets fans right now.
Mm-hmm.
You've got this guy that you built your franchise around, Ben Simmons. I don't know if he quit on the team. I don't know what – if he would – you know, he's obviously in his own head in some capacity. He's passing up open dunks in crunch time in the last 2 minutes of a game. I don't know what happened, man.
He shot the ball 0 times in the fourth quarter.
It's unbelievable.
Which is like, it's becoming
a is he doing
pattern,
a bit?
A pattern for him. I don't
Five
know.
Five shots the entire game, 4 points.
Not good.
And they were fouling him anytime he touched the ball. And his free throw percentage was the worst in NBA playoff series history.
Literally the worst.
Yep.
He's scared. Like,
worse
he's,
than Shaq.
He's scared on offense.
Like, they invented the term Hack-a-Shaq and then Hack-a-Ben and everything else, which, you know, a tired bit. But, like, when you're worse than Shaquille O'Neal was in his worst playoff series ever, like, that's just pathetic, man. Like,
it's like he has the yips or something, man. He's just not even trying.
He's going to end up somewhere. I would like to see him in a place like maybe Portland where he doesn't need to take a shot.
You think Philly moves him?
Oh, it's 100% going to happen. He's not going to be back there.
Okay. Simmons?
Yeah. I don't know what they're going to get. That. Yeah, I don't know what you can get for him, but if I'm Portland, I've got Dame Lillard who can shoot the lights out. I don't need you to ever shoot, but like Ben Simmons does some things good.
Rebounds and defense.
His passing is also very, very good.
Yeah.
He's kind of like Rondo at his worst, like offensively, basically, because Rondo used to have the knock that he cannot shoot, but he could make plays. Problem is, Rondo can make his free throws. Like, if Ben Simmons could just make free throws, he's not as big of a liability. So it's going to be a long offseason for him. I feel bad for Joel Embiid and for Seth Curry and for Paul George's ex and for Doc Rivers' hairline, I guess, but – Philly, it's an ugly day to live in that city again.
The Doc slander on the TL has been – the Doc and Simmons slander has been just heavy.
I did ask if – and I did ask Jake this morning just to piss him off, you know, who says no to Doc Rivers and Seth Curry coming back for Rick Carlisle's rights to Philly. But they're gonna. I would think you give Doc Rivers more than 1 year to make sense of that mess up there. But
yeah, I think so.
He threw Simmons under the bus. I know he was asked a fair question and he gave a straight up honest answer, which is the truth. But it's a tough look for Ben Simmons.
They were at tough look. In his press conference. Doc Rivers was asked, "Do you think you can win a championship with Ben Simmons?"
What a shit question.
And he said, "I don't know how to answer that question." Basically,
oh, that hurts to hear.
Tough scene.
Yeah.
And we got to give credit to the Hawks. You know, they did win the series.
It is so easy to say yes to that question. Like, yeah. I mean, we got some work to do.
I think Ben's a talented player. He's done really well in the league. He brings a lot to the table.
Which is a very polite way of not answering the question.
He's got some things he's got to work on this offseason to make that happen.
In all this, in a game 7 where Trae Young did not have his best effort.
Yeah. Kevin.
21 points. He was better in the fourth, but like Kevin Herter,
I believe. District 2.
District 2? Section 2.
Section 2. I don't know. It's some New York basketball thing.
New York. Okay. Hey, he's a baller, and he was – anytime he had Curry on him, like, he got whatever he wanted. Mouse in the house, to quote a great man.
I got a burger.
yeah, man. You can't lose that game 7 when, like, their best player has an off night.
Yeah.
That's insane.
I think Atlanta deserves a lot of respect. They fired their coach 24 games into the season. Nate McMillan is a good head coach. He's been in the playoffs with the Pacers, but he didn't start the season out like crafting it as his team. So, you know, it'd be a lot like if Steve Nash exited stage left midway through the season. Like, you're not going to be like, oh, D'Antoni drug this team to the championship, like, without experience. Like, you know, he's got skins on the wall. So, credit to him. I don't really love John Collins. Like, yeah, I get it. You get into a player in a series, and like for you to rub it in his face by wearing a T-shirt of you dunking on him in game 6 of that series, like after the series is over, it's like, dude, you've got to go worry about guarding Giannis in the next round. And I don't see who on your team is going to do anything about it. Giannis has his own problems. He missed a lot of free throws, but he still put up 40 and like 15 rebounds damn near every game against the Nets. So you're going to have some trouble.
Did he not wear that shirt before the game? Did he walk into the stadium wearing it? Or was it just a press conference?
I only saw the press conference shirt.
I would respect that move much more.
If he wore both before the game?
Before the game.
Yeah, I see.
Before the outcome is determined. You
that's
know what
true.
I mean?
Like, because then, like, you had the risk of, like, if you lost, then you have to own, like, trying to come
exactly.
in and touch it. I agree.
It'd be more bold.
I truly agree. And now, at this point, you know, dude. I still pick Milwaukee's going to, I think, probably in 5, maybe.
Shout out to the Hawks front office, because that team they put around Trey is really, really good.
Mm-hmm. It fits.
There's just a number of dudes who I had either forgotten about or like was completely unaware of what their game was, Herter being one of them, that just balled out. Like, yeah. Like everybody contributed. That was and I've always been a Capella guy, and I did not think he was going to be able to withstand even a hobbled Embiid, and he did.
Embiid's still 8, but Capella offensively got what he wanted for the majority of this. He wasn't the star, but he still had enough lobs, enough pick and roll success to keep that game on it, or that series honest, and mostly because Trey's such a threat off that pick and roll. So I'm interested in watching the series, but without a doubt, I'm taking Milwaukee to gentlemen sweep in 5. Phoenix, without Chris Paul in game 1, picked up a win. I didn't watch any of this game. I'm not going to fake that I did, but apparently Devin Booker's
on another planet.
You know, no Kawhi, no Chris Paul.
It's a killer, man.
Who knows?
Did you see there was another altercation with Suns fans and Clipper fans?
I did not.
Yeah.
Suns fans need to fucking tap the brakes. Like,
and it was like 20-on-2.
Oh, no.
It wasn't like it wasn't horrible, but like it was still like in the tunnel, or not in the tunnel, but the hallway of the stadium, and it was just a whole deal. But it's like, okay, have we gotten enough out of Suns and 4 guy?
Well, we can digest this another time, but apparently there's a follow-up breakdown video from the guy who got his ass beat, who inexplicably sat down to explain why he got beat up in a fight in a public. Like, dude, just fade to black, man. Like, all you got to do is answer to, like, the 6 people you work with and your girlfriend and,
He
you
did
know,
himself
move on.
Zero favors by doing that. He looks like an idiot.
Dude, some more saying so. He actually won that fight.
He had this big scratch on his nose,
and that's what happened. That's
why he ducked out, like covering his face, and it was bloody. He said he got scratched.
You know what? The weirdest thing about that entire video is why he just stayed leaned over like that.
Like, even when Suns and Four guy let go, he just kind of stayed there, like, gathering himself. Like, why didn't he just step back and then stop taking uppercuts?
Yeah.
Multiple.
Well, you know, however could a team with high ground lose a match, you know, to probably an undermanned team? Ask us later in Verdansk, I'm sure.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'll watch the series. But by this time next week, that series could be done if Phoenix runs away with it. So who knows?
I look forward to paying $49.99 to watch the rematch of Suns and Four Guy versus Nuggets Fan Man.
The undercard after, like, Elizabeth Olsen and fucking –
yeah, I don't know. It'll be the undercard to Dylan and – who was the guy you were supposed to fight? We had somebody.
Who was I supposed to fight?
I don't know. There was somebody last week.
I'll fight that guy who's trashing my hockey knowledge.
Yeah, that
I'll
dude.
I'll fight him.
It'll be that undercard.
I'll tear him up.
I hope that dude's just – what if that's the 7-foot dude?
You see my shirt? You think I can't throw hands?
Well, Dylan and I do train exclusively at Music City Boxing.
We go to Nashville for our boxing training.
I realize I'm full-blown asshole over here for not rocking my shirt in here. But thanks to KJ. Stevie.
KJ correct? Doesn't support Music City
Boxing. MCB.
Before we get into the College World Series, do you mind if I talk about Headspace, Dylan?
Please do, Dave.
It's your daily dose of mindfulness in the form of guided meditations in an easy-to-use app. Look, times are stressful. We're getting back to normal. Maybe you have to go back into the office, and that's stressing you out. Anything. You need some time alone. You need some time to kind of just wind down a little bit. Headspace is one of the only meditation apps advancing the field of mindfulness and meditation through clinically validated research. So whatever the situation, Headspace can really help you feel better. If you're overwhelmed, they've got a 3-minute SOS meditation for you. We've all used it. I used it to help me fall asleep.
I'm a big Headspace guy. I was new to the whole meditation scene, didn't know how to do it really at all, kind of intimidated by the whole situation. And so I downloaded the app, and it walks you through it. Great for beginners, or if you're experienced, it kind of helps you as well. But for beginners, it really does just kind of lay it all out for you. It's quick, it's easy, and it's very, very helpful.
Yeah. Makes it easy for you to build life-changing meditation practice with mindfulness that works for you on your schedule anytime, anywhere. It's backed by 25 published studies on its benefits, 600,000 five-star reviews, and over 60 million downloads. That's crazy. You deserve to feel happier, and Headspace is meditation made simple. Go to headspace.com/bang. That's headspace.com/bang for a free 1-month trial with access to their full library of meditations for every situation. Wow. It's the best deal offered right now. Head to headspace.com/bang today. Baseball, Dylan's favorite sport. Johnny Baseball over here. Tell us about it.
The College World Series began over the weekend.
Omaha,
yeah.
Wait, I thought it began weeks ago. When did DBU play?
The tournament started weeks ago.
That was a super regional.
Okay.
That was the mid-regional.
I'm making fun of myself because prior to this podcast, I'd yet to ever look at the bracket for College World Series.
So the tournament is very much just like the NCAA tournament, 64 teams. The final eight is called the College World Series, and it takes place, of course, in Omaha, Nebraska, formerly at Rosenblatt Stadium. Now it's like Ameritrade something.
Yep.
There's corporations.
Yeah.
Buffett money.
You know how it goes.
Mm.
So we had four games over the weekend. I watched one game, and that was a Texas game.
Okay, how'd that go
Texas
for you as
got
a viewer?
Absolutely mowed down.
Was that pitcher eating?
Oh my goodness! It was Mississippi State. Will Bednar is his name. Texas just could not touch him. He had basically two pitches. He had a fastball that he threw high. He was up in the zone pretty much the whole game, and just a devastating slider. Big sweeping slider. His shit was on. He was nasty. Texas could not touch him. 15 Ks through six plus innings.
Mm.
15 Ks. Three guys put the ball in play. That's what that means, Dave.
What were your thoughts about his personality, like his overall demeanor?
He pretty chachi.
You know,
is kind of the MO for college pitchers, I think. But he was pretty chachi, and he gave a horns down leaving the mound at one point. And
Tom Herman rolled over in his whatever
coffin. He probably cares less now.
His Yeti coffin.
Since he's no longer employed by the University of Texas. But it was just ugly. And then he hands the ball off to this kid, Sims, who was like their strikeout pitcher. Mississippi State just has a nasty staff, I think.
The Bulldogs. You know who went to Mississippi State? Former Ranger great Mitch Moreland.
A lot of people did. A lot of people went there.
Rusty Greer, did he?
Yeah, I believe so.
Very cool.
Dak?
Dakota Prescott.
Rain.
Dakota
Come
Rain.
On, dog.
Yeah, Dakota Rain.
Or Come on,
Rain,
fool.
Dakota Rain is such a...
I think it's Rain Dakota.
Pop country name. It's not even funny.
No, you're right. It's Dakota Rain. I'm fucked up over here.
So...
I am fucked up.
They tallied 21 strikeouts in total, which is just dirty. Texas pitcher Ty Madden also had a hell of a game.
T-Mad,
he gave up 2 runs, 10 Ks, which I think tied a Texas College World Series record.
Dumb idea to run a 10K in the middle of a game.
And Brooks Kieschnick. What? What'd you say?
It's a dumb idea to run a 10K in the middle of a game.
You're such an idiot. I'm talking about baseball.
Is it not a dumb idea?
Wait, they weren't just like giving, like reading out their 10K or reporting it for the quarter?
That was their 401K.
Oh, okay.
If you withdraw, you have to pay.
Yeah, Texas unfortunately got a tough first game matchup there. With
so what's next for the Longhorns in 2021?
They play Tuesday afternoon.
Yep.
And a must win. It's a win and go home. It's a double elimination. Until they get to the championship series, then the slates are wiped clean, and then it's a best out of 3 series amongst those two teams, which is a format that changed 15-ish years ago, I think.
Who do they play?
They play Tennessee. 2 o'clock.
Ooh.
Blue Bloods.
NC State beat Stanford. Vandy beat Arizona. And Virginia beat Tennessee. So, this Texas-Tennessee game is a winner go home.
Real quick, the top prospects in college baseball. Ty Madden, number 3 prospect overall as far as in college. There are a couple high school athletes, including one from Jesuit, who the Rangers might have their eyes on.
Ty Madden for Texas, who pitched last night.
Number 1, number 2, Kumar Rocker and Jack Leiter, both from Vandy.
Vandy.
So still in the tournament. Vandy also has like number 26th player overall, Isaiah Thomas, outfielder. But Tennessee, only one in the top 25, according to the CBS list that I'm looking at right now. So Max Ferguson. Number 24 overall.
Having one in the top 25 is still very impressive,
yes,
considering that a lot of guys, if they're, you know, big-time prospects, they will forego college or go the junior college route and not have to sit out 3 years before becoming eligible. Mississippi State just has a great pitching staff, unfortunately. So hopefully those guys will be burned out by the time Texas, if they get to face them again, that happens. But we'll see how it goes.
Thank you, Dylan.
We'll see how it goes.
Thank you for honestly coming in here and doing this pod today. I know you didn't want to be here.
Let me also mention the home plate umpire was atrocious last night.
Twitter didn't like it.
And I'm not saying that this isn't sour grapes, because I think the bad calls probably favored Texas more so than Mississippi State, but they were bad on both sides. The bottom of the ninth, Texas did score 1 run. They should have scored 0, honestly, but the guy extended the inning with the base hit, but he should have been called out on 2 balls that were absolutely strikes.
Was it an ump show?
He was just bad. He was just bad. He called a lot of strikes way outside the zone, and some that were very much strikes. He called balls.
Are you pro robot umpire?
Yeah. Yeah. The human element when calling balls and strikes, I think, is too. It's not great. I don't know. It's too great. It's too all over the place. Some umps have different zones. I like to call them high. I like to call them outside. And other umpires don't. Sometimes they just miss it. So
taking all the humanity out.
Balls and strikes. I think balls and strikes only should be lasered, robotic, however you want to say it.
I mean, they do it in tennis. Lasers. They do it in soccer.
You know what I mean? Like the human element shouldn't determine the outcome of a game, and it almost did last night.
I'm pro human. Just in general, but I don't know where I stand on this.
You're
KJ,
taking
can
our
you
jerks.
Convince me the other side?
Yeah.
First they came and did the pizzas. They took the balls and strikes.
Now they're taking our jerks.
Easy. I'm pro jobs, as we all know. And an umpire would be one job. A robot umpire would take a lot more people to create that robot.
That's
maintenance
fair.
And keep it up. Ooh. So create all of those jobs and get that one dude out of here.
What about the carbon footprint that it would take to?
Excellent. So I need that umpire to retrain his skills to come up with something to get rid of that carbon. That's his job now.
You saying learn to code?
Learn to code, bruh.
Oh, wow. So dismissive.
It's part of my green initiative. Learn to code.
You guys aren't going to believe where I stand on this issue, but we don't really have time to get into that now because we got to talk about the Supreme Court.
Doom, doom.
KJ, I hope you're well-versed on this because
this dropped when I was recording Circling Back.
Yes, I read up a little bit, and it's actually a continuation on something that's it's been going on since 2019, and we gave the fast rundown of this back in the fall. But in short, this morning, the Supreme Court ruled 9-0 that basically affirmed lower court rulings that prevented the NCAA from restricting – this is off the top of my head, by the way prevented the NCAA from restricting payments to athletes for items such as musical instruments or as compensation for internships. The NCAA was arguing to cap payments on those sorts of things. So basically saying – which, you know, we're team no cap for sure.
Yeah.
They wanted to maintain control over amateurism, that if they opened the floodgates on allowing schools, states to regulate whether or not players could be paid for even name, image, likeness rules, which we'll get into in a second, that there was going to be no limit on me, I don't know, Rhett Bomar comes to mind, hiring a player as an intern and then just paying him thousands of dollars to do nothing for that internship. The NCAA was like, we need to put a cap on how much these players can make in these things. 9-0, every Supreme Court justice said, fuck that. Like, no, like that's not the American way. And it wasn't clear what they were arguing for. Tomorrow and the next day, NCAA will be meeting to further discuss this ruling internally. But everyone expects that basically the writing's been on the wall for months, and I can kind of give a quick timeline here in a second. And then on the 28th of this month, expect an announcement from the NCAA saying, like, hey, we're getting out of the way. Because on July 1st, several states, including Texas, Georgia, Mississippi, I've got the rest of the list here, Alabama, Florida, New Mexico, all of their name, image, likeness laws go into effect. Oddly enough, what got the ball rolling is that California was the first one to drop a law on the NCAA and say, get, you know, figure this out. We're going to allow players to do this by a certain date, and their law doesn't go into effect until later on this year. So it's been going on since 2019. As of July 1st, in those states, you know, the teams can come to agreements. And I think the first agreement was already announced recently, where I think it's like the entire University of Georgia football team will receive payments for – I don't know if it was Adidas or somebody, but they did it as a block agreement with the entire team. So storm's coming.
Hmm. Sounds like a Neil Gorsuch joint. Did he pen this opinion?
I think he was him and Kavanaugh both had their opinions were whatever you want to call. I'm not. You're the chain.
He drank beer.
Fucking tell me the words that I'm supposed to use in here. I saw their words.
They wrote the opinion.
There you go. Dylan, it does bring me to a question here in relation to what you're talking about as far as players who go JUCO route versus college and all of that. Like, this doesn't just affect football. This is every sport at play here. So, like, then if I'm a baseball player and I know I can go make money playing college baseball as opposed to riding it out for the Round Rock Express or the Des Moines Thunderbutts, like.
So that's a quick way, in your opinion, to become a household name is through college?
Maybe make money and be in a nicer experience, you know, hang out with some co-eds. Little PMV action there.
That's interesting.
POV action.
POD for sure.
That's interesting. If you're a big time prospect, and you have a chance to start for a Texas, a USC, a team like that.
Oh, here we go.
But yeah, no, it's true.
Those are big brands.
But you've got to start making the money make sense. Of like, jeez, the Yankees will throw $1 million at a high school kid to go sit and. I'm going to keep naming cities and places. People, Fort Wayne. I've seen their stadium. It's pretty tight. And go sit and play there for a couple of years, bounce around
and
until
like
you get to the league.
Podunk towns,
exactly.
Too. Yeah.
So now I can go into Austin for 4 years, be a big name, get money, you know, hang out with the Minister of Culture, and then make my way to the league.
Honestly, that's kind of dope, Dave.
They threw $300K at a dude from my high school, and he bought an F-350. It's a true story.
Did he buy it?
Same thing
truck
happened
month?
Here.
He was, well, yeah.
It was truck month.
Every day was truck month back then.
Sure.
Times were different.
Yeah.
Drastically change. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the only negative, I think, is that it makes strong, like big branded programs even bigger.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in more of a, you know, more enticing for these kids to sign up. Yep. It's just, yeah, but I'm for it.
Yeah, I've already kind of put on my opinions out, my bad opinions, apparently, or unpopular opinions, if you will, on not necessarily being on the side of like, okay, pay players, just because I haven't seen a tangible system that's going to work. But I don't think that should get in the way of logic of saying if there's money being made, the players deserve a cut of that pie. where I began to kind of lose faith in that thought is like, there's a lot of money in high school sports. Like, where are we going to begin saying like amateurism starts and stops? Like, okay, can I sign a high school kid to deal? Because high school kids are announcing their like all-star game appearances in 2024 right now.
Some five-star running back, like, you know, big-time program.
Dude, they're announcing what high school they're going to transfer to.
Yes, or that they're not even going to they're opting out of their final year and putting in a notes app. Yeah. Like,
Texas recruit.
Graphics. The problem is graphics are too easy to make. they have too much access to graphics online.
Meme lord over here, upset at ease of Adobe Spark.
It's just too easy. Like, they're teaching the kids. It's so young these days.
As Brett would say, keep an eye out. I would expect the next news to drop on this on the 28th of this month. And then as of the 1st of next month, kids in town are going to be getting checks cut for, who knows, it'll be interesting to see how it goes.
Interesting. So are you putting a major bag alert out there or a major bag watch?
I think
a fair market bag alert.
A fair market bag alert is definitely.
Okay.
A warning for sure, not just a watch, because you know it's out there.
You know what's in my bag?
Vizzy
Hard Seltzer.
There you go.
It's one of those insulated ones that keeps them cool.
One of those bison ones?
Yeah. Dude, Vizzy Hard Seltzer, man. Where do I begin? There's no... Probably with seltzer that I want to drink.
I would begin
more.
Talking about the Acerola, which is a superfruit.
It has vitamin C, antioxidant vitamin C.
Super fruity.
It's a superfruit. Do the thing.
Acerola is a superfruit. Superfruit. Do the last line.
This is your thing.
It's superfruity.
I don't like how soulful you get on the last.
It's superfruity.
Yeah.
I kind of crush
He's
it.
Like self-auto-tuning. I respect it.
It's pretty good. You're kind of the T-Pain of the pod.
Is that goatee?
D-Pain.
Peter Gabriel.
They call you
go on.
D-Pain over
here. They
do
call me D-Pain.
Pre-Pain. Well, pre. I'm sorry.
We already did the D-Pain segment. We're in a read. Let's
Vizzy
go.
Vizzy is more than just a hard seltzer with vitamin C, KJ. They celebrate inclusion, and they've donated $1 million to the human rights campaign over 3 years to support their fight for LGBTQ+ equality. There are plenty of hard seltzers to choose from. Plenty. Look, we know that. We go to the stores. We shop. Not to brag, but we go to the grocery store.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes I'm like overwhelmed. I'm like, dude, just get me to the Vizzy. I got to weed through this one and that one that I don't want. There's a new one popping up every day. But let me tell you, there's nothing out there. Nothing quite like Vizzy. They include my favorite flavor, of course. I said this earlier, peach lemonade. They got the new lemonade flavors, the peach one that I just mentioned, raspberry,
watermelon's
strawberry.
Watermelon's the best. Watermelon lemonade.
You're a big watermelon guy. And here's the thing. I skipped over this. To celebrate pride, excuse me, in a meaningful way, they're creating a labelless can to reinforce the beauty of loving our unique personal identity and living beyond pre-assumed labels. No labels, bro.
It might be labelless, but it's the sexiest labelless can I've ever seen. Have you seen it?
I think you're right.
I picked one up at Mudhook in Duncanville. They were great.
I like the Instagram they posted. Look, it's exciting. It's a limited edition. Get them now. I don't know. We could just sit here and talk about our favorite Vizzy flavors, but we like them all. Really, there's not one that I'm never sad when I open up my fridge and see I've got like one or two left because I know I'm going to like those no matter what flavors. I might be partial to the peach strawberry or the peach lemonade, but that's fine. That's I'll drink whatever.
Yeah. BCL, black cherry lime.
There you go. Upgrade your hard seltzer to Vizzy. To find out where you can purchase their limited edition Pride Package or any of their other refreshing flavors, go to VizzyHardSeltzer.com/washed. That's VizzyHardSeltzer.com/washed. To get updates on their latest flavor drops and more, sign up for emails at VizzyHardSeltzer.com/subscribe. You got to be 21 or older, okay?
Can I solicit some unsolicited Viz picks out there? Why don't you at Too Much Dip or Meat Smokers Only? No, you'll get that RT on Insta.
This guy wants to party.
Wow. Some unsolicited Viz picks.
Wow.
On that note, let's take this thing to the party.
Party time, baby.
We got to talk Euro Cup. Oh, yeah, no, it says check out Sunday Scaries for a deeper review. If you want. This completely fooled me. I hadn't looked at the sports party yet. Yeah, I did watch Hungary, France. That was my Saturday morning, more than y'all did. Dylan, you're probably hungover.
No, but I didn't watch soccer. Actually, I was low-key hungover. That's fact.
I watched the first half of Czechoslovakia. Czechoslovakia, correct? No, Czech Republic, because this is an
1812. Yeah, Czechoslovakia no longer exists.
Freaking bread over
here. Sorry,
I've
been playing Call of Duty Cold War too much. Yes, Czech Republic, and the other team that has Luka Modric on it. I'm just killing it right now. What the hell is that team?
What team?
It ain't hard to say.
Yeah,
really.
Whatever. I watched the Euro Cup. I watched the first half. Luka Modric and his
Croatia.
Team. Thank you.
Duh, dude.
Green stuff.
Croatia, I knew it
they came
the
back
time.
To they came back to tie, just like France-Hungary. I don't think we've had too many big upsets yet. The group of F, or the group of death, as I like to call it, has provided a lot of excitement. But, you know, catch me waiting on the group or the round of 16, which should be starting this weekend.
Dylan, tell me about your Golden Knights.
Golden Knights. Of course, they won game one. Kind mm-hmm. of kind of in dominating fashion, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Dropped games two and three, which your boy did not like seeing.
So it's over. Series is done.
It looked pretty grim last night through two periods because it was 1-0 Montreal. And guess what happened, Dave? Golden Knights scored. Talking OT. Boom. Golden Knights win in OT. Series tied 2-2. Going back to Vegas. It's now a three-game series. Vegas has home ice advantage. Let's fucking go.
Quick question there. What do you think about Fleury's faux pas, if you will, damn near own goal in it in game four and costing them that game?
In game four?
Game four, I believe, is where he tried to settle the puck in front of the net and cost them a goal. And I think that was a game deciding goal. Lost 2-1. They pull Fleury in game five, and he sits on the bench.
Game four was last night.
Game three, you're right. Okay. I'm sorry. Yes, my math is bad. But yeah, they pulled him. He didn't play last night. Whoever
he did not
played,
play last night. Robin Leonard, yes. Leonard played last night.
So do you want to see Fleury back out there or let the hot hand play?
I want to see Fleury. I want to see Fleury back out there. He's got the experience. He's had a better overall playoffs. They let Leonard start game one of which series was it? It may have been the opening series. I forgot. Anyway, and he had an atrocious game.
Gotcha.
Pulled him. And Fleury's been pretty strong up until that faux pas.
Question and topic entirely sponsored by Brett Marion.
Yeah. I can't wait to hear about how I
no, fumbled. You got it right. I'm saying I butchered the question because Brett had to feed that to me. But yeah,
Islanders
I'm also watching.
Lightning knotted up as well, too.
Yes. I'm all Islanders on that because fuck the Ning.
Yeah, get out
don't
here,
you start doing it too. You're gonna make it a thing.
Did y'all watch any of the French Grand Prix?
I did
again.
I did. You know, this brings a lot of strategy questions into play. Was it a one-stop race? Was it two? We're talking pit stops, Dylan. It's where you get your tires changed and stuff. For me, my theory and what I would do, I would simply have no stops, so I wouldn't waste any time.
And how would you remedy the fuel running out?
Just keep going.
Really?
Run on vibes, I think.
Run on vibes. If my tires can't take it, then I didn't deserve to win. That's really? How I look at it. Yeah, Lewis Hamilton held the lead, and then I don't know what lap toward the end that Verstappen got him, but it was a fun race.
A lot of chatter on Twitter. It kind of feels like the sport is gaining popularity over here, which is fun to see.
It absolutely is.
Yeah, it's fun. Probably in large part to the Netflix documentary.
I would say so,
done a lot.
How much money
for
do you think that they deserve, like, if that just continues? Because it's a one-to-one correlation, in my opinion. Like, it's obviously it got us all into it. You know, I've got my dad into it, and everybody else that I've talked to who knows about F1 now is on the backs of this, you know, show. That's incredibly successful. I can't say the same for any of the other style shows, and I'm very happy that it's happened because the F1 production, in terms of it being a two-hour experience, Sunday morning when you weren't doing shit else, like, it's perfect.
Yeah.
Extra sports.
A lot
Speaking of
fun.
Extra sports, a very extra sport.
Ooh.
Los Olympicos.
The Olympics.
Sorry, I was in Mexico recently. Olympics are back soon.
Hey, glaring lack of you running into the ocean, by the way.
Okay. Full disclosure, we did have a little session of sitting on the beach in a little daybed. I'm just put it out there. Your boy basically just fell asleep on the daybed. And Nicole's like, hey, do you want to go down and get in the water? I was like, oh, I'm good here. I was like, bring me another whatever you got on that tray.
Something tall and strong?
Yeah.
Get a hurricane?
And I fully, fully prepared for this moment. I purchased a hat for this moment. It was a really ugly hat. I didn't keep it. It was a cheap hat at the gift shop for like $22. It's bad. Purchased a hat for this moment. I stretched lay down on that day bed and your boy caught some Z's. So bad performance by me. Dylan won, zero me on the ocean runs.
You know, the key is to you gotta get those knees high.
Yeah.
You know, you gotta chop.
The key is to go out there and do it, is really. Yeah. And fucking film it. Stop being a bitch like I was.
Damn.
Anyhow.
Damn.
Olympics are back. Trials are on. Swimming and track and field started this weekend. I'm sure we'll get some gymnastics next week.
Hey, so
I am capital H for the Olympics.
Is this white kid bowling? Is he not as fast as we thought he was?
He is, but it's, I think it's just different at this point.
Well, know? Yeah, I mean, he's trying to qualify for to be one of the fastest man alive. I get it, but
in high school and taps, like where he was, I guess 2 years ago is when he kind of made his name. He's a sophomore, junior. Shit, we were just
UGA,
talking about
UGA, right?
Yeah, UGA. So we were just talking about him last July. So this must be the end of his freshman year at Georgia. I just think he's probably 2 or 3 years out of training like a professional level athlete. He has skills. He has talent. I mean, the guys that he's racing against are like about to race for gold. Like, you know, he probably could compete at the Czech Republic. Definitely at Czechoslovakia.
Yeah, he'd probably be great back then. okay. He so is built Serbia, Montenegro, like ninth?
There were 8 runners in his heat. He finished seventh because the eighth guy pulled up with a bad hamstring.
That's tough.
But, hey, okay. He still was there in Olympic trials. So
you weren't there?
That's still top 20 or 30 in the nation.
Safe to say he would beat me in a foot race, Dave, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, shout out to Dallas Carter's own Sha'Carri Richardson.
Sha'Carri?
Really? Dallas yes. Carter, huh?
If I raised young Kai through his high school years in my current home, he would have to attend Dallas Carter, which means I will not be raising Kai to his high school years.
Wait.
My house falls into Carter High School District for no reason.
I've got a lot of questions because you live.
Yeah.
How are you not in DeSoto?
It's a problem. They needed some tax dollars, I guess. I don't know.
Oh, wow.
It gets split, that. Junior high and West. Anyways, niche high school districting talk.
I mean, he'll get recruited to go to Duncanville. I mean, if they recruit, I don't think they do that.
That's never happened before. Any Olympics that you guys are actually like into enough to watch the trials for or watch like pre-Olympic content?
Trials, no, but women's gymnastics is so fun.
I'll be watching gymnastics. Guys.
And I'm not, this is not an H, this isn't H related.
Okay.
What do you mean?
It's become a very popular series of events.
I agree.
Simone Biles. Straight up goated, not even low key, not sneaky. She's just absolutely goated.
Dude, Dylan brought the take cannon.
Here's what I'm wondering though. Women's gymnastics are usually good for like 3 years, like that's the prime of their ability.
Okay.
And then when they're like 17 years old, Simone Biles is a little older now, and the Olympics got pushed a year. Is she gonna be? I know she's gonna be there, but is she still on top of her game?
She will dwarf anybody because I think she was fairly young last Olympics. So
okay, she is a freak, man.
That's the weird thing about Olympics is like you just have to kind of be born on the right year for some of these sports to get like in swimming, Kate Ledecky.
Yeah.
Who's extremely talented. And now they've got a 15-year-old, another Kate from Iowa, I want to say, who's going to be making her first Olympics. And now she'll be able to go there for 15, 19, potentially in 23.
You'll hear some of the commentary on the Olympics and like, oh yeah, she's 16, so this will probably be her last Olympics. Like, what are you talking about? She's a child.
I'll be all over this because in my household, my wife did gymnastics growing up for quite a while. Yeah, and so she's excited. She told me this morning.
Yeah.
So this week, we're going to watch some gymnastics stuff, so I guess I'll be watching some of that.
Men's 100 in women's gymnastics, because you got to see who the fastest man in the world is. You just got to.
Men's 200s. Fucking awesome to see as well. Yeah. 800, it gives me cramps watching. That is the hardest race on the planet. I'm going to publicly solicit, let me rephrase this, publicly appeal to both your wife and intern Klein Siguth. You know, can we get some actual gymnastics knowledge? Maybe there are correspondents come actual Olympics time. Because otherwise, I don't want to be in here being like, oh, and that woman from Czechoslovakia just really dominated on the all-around.
And U.S. women's cleans up.
Yes.
They are legit.
Yes.
Dave.
I'm excited. New sports this year. I think baseball's back in it.
New
golf
sport
is
alert.
Still there. And skateboarding, I believe, is there. So
yeah, I was supposed to be in it, but.
But you're not good anymore?
No, I hit my toe on like the dog ball. I like stubbed it. It was just painful. You guys ready to run it back?
Yeah.
Let's run it back, Dylan.
Oh, gosh. All right. We're running it back.
Oh, no.
Of course, running it back is the segment during which we talk about what we already talked about. Dylan fumbled his first ever Too Much Dip tweet. Rhodes made his pod debut. Actually, more of a virtual happy hour, but we heard him. Dylan enjoys sports representing cultures and ethnic backgrounds from all over the globe, despite what KJ would allude to. KJ had an Auburn muff. His word.
His words.
His words.
It's in quotes.
Dylan won't get that thing bleached.
That is facts.
KJ likes his streakers fully nude or get out. Also supports naked tasing.
Wow. KJ. Back the blue.
KJ doesn't support Music City Boxing like Dylan and Dave do. Thank you again for the shirt.
Whatever. Yeah, thank you, Music City Boxing. I will do a training camp there before it's all said and done.
Mississippi State's pitcher, Walla Chach, was dealing Sunday.
Chach bag.
Robots are taking our gerbs. Bag alert. Fair market bag alert. KJ speaks Spanish now. And Dave will not appear in the Olympics in the skateboarding event.
You know, and
much
that's
to everyone's surprise.
I'm excited for that. That is this year?
I don't know.
You know what they say, dude. Skate or die, so.
They do.
Is it the half pipe?
I got my half pipe.
They're actually doing a full pipe. It's crazy. They're doing loops.
It's just guys pulling pipes, so it's just a long drive. Mm-hmm. Why is the long drive not in there? They should have long drive.
Is golf back this year?
Yeah, Zazie Beetz or, damn it, that's not her name. She also has big hair, though.
Troy Mullins?
Yes.
What do you want her in there for?
Hey, remember when
really
Ricky...
like her swing.
I want women's long drivers.
Remember when Ricky Fowler got the tattoo?
Yeah. And then,
the rings.
And then they just got their...
Did he get bronze?
They got their asses beat in.
But wasn't the scoring or how they did that event in Brazil like,
I don't remember
really
how it
janky?
It
wasn't even match play. It was kind of weird. But I don't know. I'm all in. What I don't need is like a Ryan Lochte type story, like trying to make a name for himself. And I'm not talking about the bathroom like wreckage, but like every year there's somebody who has to try to become the bad boy or the cool bro, like all the way back to, I know we're in overtime here. Whatever
Dan and
his
Dave?
Name is. No, what's the guy's name? Brody, the skier.
Brody Miller.
Brody Miller.
Bodie Miller.
Bodie Miller.
Bodie Miller.
Like, I don't need that this year, but more Olympics this summer. Goodbye. Sorry, your boy's on one today.
That's it.
Bye.
We'll be back next week.
I want my chips with a dip. That's all I know.
Sports are just
I don't want my chips playing. I want my chips with a dip. I'll bring them dips.